This video is provided as supplementary material for courses taught at Howard Community College. And in this video, I want to do a few more examples of finding the trigonometric function values given a point on the terminal side of an angle. So here's the first problem. We're given the point 2, 3. We're told that's on the terminal side of an angle, and we have to find some of the trigonometric function values for it. So to understand this, let's draw a simple graph, and we'll label the point 2, 3. And using that point, I'm going to draw a line from the point to the origin and say that the angle that that forms is angle theta. Then I'm going to draw another line vertically down from that point to the x-axis, and that will give me a side opposite that angle theta. And the length of that side is going to be the y value for the point. So the length of that side is going to be 3. For the side adjacent to angle theta, I'm going to have a length of 2. That's the x value for the point. So now I know the opposite side, the opposite is 3, and the adjacent is 2. Using that information and the Pythagorean theorem, I can find this diagonal line, which is the hypotenuse. So the hypotenuse is going to equal the square root of the opposite side squared, that's going to be 3 squared, plus the adjacent side squared, that's 2 squared. That's going to give me the square root of 3 squared, which is 9, plus 2 squared, which is 4. And that will equal the square root of 13, which can't be reduced. Okay, so now we know that the hypotenuse has a length of square root of 13. With those two sides and the hypotenuse, I can now find trigonometric function values. So if I want to find the sine of theta, all I have to do is take the opposite side, which is 3, and put that over the hypotenuse, which is the square root of 13. Now, you might be told that you're not supposed to leave radical signs in the denominator. If you're given that, then what you've got to do is multiply this fraction, 3 over the square root of 13, by the fraction square root of 13 over the square root of 13. That second fraction just equals 1, but when we multiply, we get 3 times the square root of 13. And in the denominator, we have the square root of 13 times the square root of 13, so that's just 13. And now we've got the sine of theta as a fraction without a radical sign in the denominator. For the cosine of theta, we're going to get the opposite side, which is 2 over the square root of 13. And we'll do the same trick to get rid of the radical sign. We'll multiply by the square root of 13 over the square root of 13. That's going to give us 2 times the square root of 13 over 13. For the tangent, we just take the opposite, which is 3, over the adjacent, which is 2, and we can just leave it as that, 3 over 2. For the reciprocal functions, cosecant, secant, and cotangent, we're just going to take the values we got for sine, cosine, and tangent and invert them, take their reciprocals, and that'll be the values for the other three functions. Okay, let's do one more. This one has some fractions and square roots in it. So I've got a point, negative 1 over 4, comma, negative square root of 3 over 4. Okay, so as before, we know that the opposite side is going to have a length that's the same as the y value. So that's negative square root of 3 over 4. And the adjacent side is going to be negative 1 over 4. Let's see, that would put this terminal point in the third quadrant. We want to find the hypotenuse, so that's going to equal the square root of, let's put this in parentheses, negative square root of 3 over 4 squared plus negative 1 over 4 squared. This simplifies nicely when we square everything. We're going to get the square root of negative square root of 3, negative square root of 3 over 4 squared is going to be 3 over 16 plus negative 1 over 4 squared will be 1 over 16. That's going to equal the square root of 4 over 16, which is the same as 2 over 4. I could reduce this down to 1 over 2, but since my sides both have denominators that are 4, I'm going to leave this as 2 over 4. You'll see why in a second. Okay, so I've got the two sides, the opposite side and the adjacent side, and the hypotenuse. And now I want to find, let's say, the sine. So the sine of theta is going to be that opposite side, that's negative square root of 3 over 4 over 2 over 4. Now let's just remember something about fractions when we deal with this, and we can make it very simple. I've got a fraction divided by a fraction. When that happens, I take the first fraction, negative 3 over 4, that's divided by the second fraction, 2 over 4, and I can rewrite that as that same first fraction, negative square root of 3 over 4, times the reciprocal of the second fraction, which is 4 over 2, and then those 4s are going to cancel, and I'm going to get negative square root of 3 over 2. Okay, so this sine of theta can be reduced very simply if I just disregard in each of the fractions the denominators. In the fraction in the numerator and the fraction in the denominator, I just end up with negative square root of 3 over 2. The same kind of thing is going to happen when I want to do the cosine. So the cosine of theta is going to equal negative 1 over 4, that's the adjacent, over the hypotenuse, which is 2 over 4. I'm going to cancel out both of those 4s, and I just get negative 1 half. And for the tangent, tangent theta, I'm going to have negative square root of 3 over 4 over, negative square root of 3 over 4 over negative 1 over 4. I can cancel out the 4s. I've got two negative signs, so that's positive. And all I've got here is just going to be the square root of 3. Okay? And once again, given this information, you can fairly easily get your reciprocal function values, your cosecant, secant, and cotangent. Okay? I hope this helps. Take care. I'll see you next time.